Good morning, Holy Spirit. Welcome. Things look a little bit different today up here, as you can see. We have a special guest today, multi-talented pastor. So I'm going to need a lot of help from everybody out there. Stand as you are able and sing along at worship.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We'll wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. Do not fail.
Joining us today in worship. We're glad you're here. It's the start of spring break, and I'm delighted that so many of you are doing spring break with us. We're glad you're here, and thanks for Gary and Linda inviting in an old hack like myself, and so I appreciate you guys tolerating me on this morning, and hope that you all can do the same. Special greeting to those of you who are joining us via our live stream, and just to let y'all know, the band's back next week. You can breathe easy. I don't think that I ran them off. We look forward to that. His kids, we're glad you're here and you started worship with us, and now we'd love for you to go off to Children's Church and have fun there. Feel free to join this parade if that is of interest to you, those of you who have young children. If this is your first time here, you'll note in the chair backs in front of you that there is a connection card. We'd love to have your information so that we can keep up with you to let you know what is going on around here and how you can participate in our life together. And I'm happy to hear children that excited to be at church on a Sunday morning. There are also brown worship pads that are on the center aisle of our rows. Feel free to sign in and send that down the row so that others can do the same. Several announcements to share with you this morning. Hopefully you saw earlier in the week the sad news that we shared with you that Bev Dara passed away, although we know that that's actually really good news for her and that she is enjoying her new life in Christ. But for those of us left behind, that means that there is an absence and a hole there. And so you are invited to join Bev's family at the Howard Quattlebaum Funeral Home on US 1 in North Palm Beach tomorrow at 2 p.m. in the afternoon. And this is for that sort of traditional practice of the calling hours at the funeral home. Her memorial service is going to be after Easter. There were spring break conflicts and things happening around here, so just wanted you to know that that opportunity to meet the family happens tomorrow afternoon, and then we'll come together and celebrate her life at a date to be named after Easter. We are a polling place, so the election is this Tuesday. Note that it may be a little busier around here in our parking lot if you have reason to be up here on Tuesdays. We are grateful to serve our community in that way and to host them. There is our envelope fundraiser that continues on the patio through the month of March. Those envelopes ask for you to donate money. That goes in support of our Soul Fire Youth Program. Firstly, the Luther Rock trip that comes annually every year. It's now about $700 per kid for them to attend camp. And so your generosity goes a long way in helping us get as many kids to camp as want to go. If there's any remainder, then we take advantage of that money for programming throughout the rest of the year. So thank you for being so generous in the ways you always support that. If you grabbed a bag of Easter eggs that needed candy stuffed in them last week, there are bins out there for you to return those Easter eggs that you put the candy in. If those are coming back still empty, but there's no bag of candy, you're going to be contacted. We expected that candy to go in the eggs. Look for the collection tub that's out there. That event happens 2 weeks from today. That's the weekend of Easter. 2 weeks from yesterday, the weekend of Easter. So Saturday at 9 a.m. we get started, and we're always grateful for the ways that you encourage those in your neighborhood and within your family to come and to be part of those events. And so we look forward to hosting those kids 2 weekends from now. That also means the Easter Pier service is 2 weekends from now on Easter Sunrise. That is on Sunday. And we have two opportunities for you to volunteer at 6:45 a.m. or at 8:45 a.m. We also need help setting up the Saturday before, after the Easter egg hunt. And we would love to have any of that help from you. Krista will be out on the patio with a sign-up sheet today. She can tell you about the opportunities. And if you've never volunteered at the pier and you'd like to know how to do that in whatever role you're in, we're having a volunteers meeting on Monday, March 25th at 6 p.m. to orient you to the work at the pier. This, as you may remember, is the Sunday that we are returning our commitment cards. Hopefully those found their way to your mailboxes this week, if not a little earlier. And then there is a wrapped box that's on a table up here at the center aisle, and it looks a lot like a gift. You're going to hear a little more about why that is a gift box, but there's a slot in there for you to return your commitment card as you make your way up to communion. We recognize that some of you have already turned in commitment cards. Some of you do that online, so please don't feel guilty if you're passing by and not putting something in there. But we do want to celebrate all this hard work that we've been doing as a congregation, and that's one of the things that we're doing today. Those are all the announcements that I have for you as a means of conversation to get started and to chat with your neighbor. What were you doing 5 years ago today? I will tell you what I was doing. It was a Sunday. I was in worship, and I was getting married. And so Nicole and I are celebrating 5 years today. So it only makes sense that we would be in worship again to celebrate our anniversary. So Stan, tell each other what you were doing 5 years ago during this time.
At a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say, word of God speak. But you poured out my grain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, word of God speak. In the midst of you, behind the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, word of God speak. Would you pour down my grain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, word of God speak. Pour down my grain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
And if you'd please pray with me. Gracious God, we ask that you would come and speak through your word, through song, through the people that we exchange greetings with, that you'd build us into a Christian community that is always listening for you. Come now, speak into our hearts. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And please be seated.
Good morning. Reading from John chapter 12, verses 20 through 33. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will be my servant also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks, Joe.
And please pray with me. Gracious God, we are grateful that your Son came to fulfill his work, and that he then hands that mission off to us. Teach us what it means to be followers of him, to go to and through the cross. We ask this all in Jesus' name, amen. So the gospel reading this morning begins by telling us that some Greeks found one of Jesus' disciples and told him they wished to see Jesus. And you may not have even paid much attention to that as you heard it read. But believe it or not, that's a big deal. These Greeks, most likely, were Greek Gentiles who had converted to Judaism. They were tourists of sorts, having traveled from their homelands to Jerusalem to be part of the Passover festival. There could have been any number of reasons they wanted to see Jesus. In the scene before this one we read today, Jesus had just entered Jerusalem riding on a donkey with everyone waving palms, which we'll celebrate next Sunday with Palm Sunday. Maybe that event made those Greeks curious. A week or so before all of this, Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, which prompted the temple priests to start plotting his death. Maybe rumors were circulating and they wanted to see who all the talk was about. But in John's gospel, this moment when the Greeks finally come seeking Jesus is pivotal. If you recall, there are several times when Jesus refuses to do things because the hour for his glory to be revealed had not yet come. Jesus told his mother that at the wedding of Cana when he turned water to wine. When Jesus feeds the 5,000, the people there wanted to make him king then and there on the spot. And Jesus withdrew from them because it was not yet his time to be glorified. But as we read on in today's account, Jesus says, "It's for this reason that I've come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." John's point in telling us that some Greeks came seeking Jesus is important, because it's now clear that Jesus has come not just as a Jewish Messiah, but he's come as Savior of the whole world, Jews and Greeks alike, Israelite and Gentile both, the insiders and the outsiders. The time has come. It's time to go to the cross. where salvation and freedom will be accomplished for everyone. It's amazing what God is doing here in this place. I'm told that many of you are noticing momentum picking up. Expectancy about our future together is growing. And with us for these past years are going to stop and come and visit to see what all the talk and the rumors about. Local tourists, if you will, are going to come here to see what's the big deal. They, like the Greeks, will want to find out more about this Jesus who's led us along these past years and brought us to this moment. And we should be thinking carefully about what and who they will find here among us. On the way to the top of the highest peak in the French Alps, there is supposedly a small inn. Maybe it's a fabled inn. This inn provides rest and respite for mountain climbers. It's called the Mediocre Inn, which in French simply means halfway. Imagine coming off a day of climbing in the icy, windy French Alps. The cold has seeped into your bones. You're exhausted. Every muscle in your body hurts. At the Mediocre Inn, you find a hot meal and a warm bed. You begin to relax, put your feet up, get comfortable. Who wouldn't like that? But success is not found in rest and comfort. Success, reaching the top of the mountain, requires going back out into the cold and wind. It requires stretching and straining and working toward the goal. About 80% of climbers never go any farther than the Mediocre Inn. Once they've had a day or two of rest and comfort, they turn around and they descend the mountain, never reaching the Alps' highest peak. They lose the determination to reach their final goal. It's tempting for you and I, and for those who will come to look, to think that we have arrived, to think that we've done enough, to think that way would be nothing more than to turn this place into mediocre Lutheran church, even though we probably aren't even halfway to the top. We can stop here, get our own hot coffee and a couple of cookies on the patio, put our feet up and get comfortable. But I don't think that's what God's called us to do. I think there's a higher peak God has in mind. God hasn't called us to mediocrity. He's called us somewhere else. This is Commitment Card Sunday, the conclusion of our annual appeal, Living Differently. Choosing to push past a stop at mediocrity is living differently. This is our challenge. Have you gotten comfortable in your giving, thinking it's enough to stop where you are? Have you gotten comfortable in your serving, thinking it's enough to stop where you are? I promise you that Holy Spirit has more ministry to accomplish in Palm Beach County. And you're being asked to get uncomfortable, to stretch, to move past a cozy place, even though you've got no certainty about what lies ahead. God didn't build all of this to house a social club that shares warm coffee and gets comfortable. God built this place to house God's people, a community of believers that know Him, that are close with Him, in relationship with Him, a community that serves Him. As often as we stop short of becoming servants, we stop at mediocrity. God isn't looking for lip service people where we speak His words but seldom live them. He's looking for people who take those words and engrave them on their hearts, as the prophet Jeremiah wrote. He's searching for people of conviction, maybe even people of conversion, ones who will make their lives conformed to His ways. And that typically isn't a popular message. Mediocrity is for the masses, 80% or so. I think He's looking for the 20% who will go to the top, even fewer if need be, because the top can be a hard climb. Many are called, few are chosen. I think that's scripture. Many find mediocrity, few find the top. And I think that's because the top comes with a difficult price. For at the top of the mountain to which Jesus calls us to follow him stands a cross. Jesus tells those Greek looky-loos who come to find him that those who love their life lose it. Those who hate their life for this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. And that's not a popular message. Jesus, the water to wine guy, is fun. Jesus, the bread for 5,000 out of a couple of loaves guy, that's convenient. But Jesus, the unless a seed dies guy, the follow me to the cross guy, well, a lot of people fall off the trail around the mediocre point. Author Craig Barnes writes, if we spend years achieving all of our dreams, all we've really done is close the distance between death and us. As Jesus kept trying to explain, those who try to save their lives will lose them. Eventually, we will lose our jobs, our relationships, our health, everything we are pushing to save. Barnes reminds us that after the resurrection of Christ, when the church first began, it struggled through periods of persecution for 300 years. And every Sunday, when the believers gathered, they took time to embrace and love each other because they did not know who might be martyred for the faith before their next gathering. Maybe you think about that the next time we're greeting people around here on Sunday morning. Why were so many willing to lay down their lives for the confession that Jesus is Lord? Well, because when they were baptized, symbolically, they were buried with Christ. They had already died to all of the old dreams for life. And as Barnes puts it, you just can't scare dead people. If you're going to make it to the top, which, by the way, is where a cross waits for you, you can't afford to be scared. If we really understand about our lives no longer belonging to us, but instead belonging to God, the rest of the climb isn't that tough. If we're going to be a church that flourishes in an ever-increasing culture of apathy, we have to keep stretching. But getting to that point where mediocrity no longer looks comfortable, that point where the words move from our lips into our hearts, that's the tough part. You don't belong to yourselves. You belong to the one who paid for you with his life. Are you ready to go the rest of the way with him and leave comfortable mediocrity behind? There's an old word of mouth story about Abraham Lincoln prior to becoming president, and it tells of a time when he visited a slave auction. Observing the proceedings from the rear of the crowd, his attention was caught by a strong, defiant young slave girl with sharp, angry eyes. Something in her manner pierced him. The sheer intensity of her gaze spoke to him of the anguish of her captivity and her longing for freedom. When it was her turn to step to the auction block, he and several others bid. With each rise in price, her hostility grew. Finally, Lincoln won, paid the money, and had her brought to him. And she came rigid with resistance, arms tied behind her back, leg chains dragging. "Untie her," Lincoln said. "Oh, no, sir," her auctioneer responded, pulling her forward with a jerk. "She be a wild one. Ain't no end of trouble in her. You best get her home before you taking her chains off." And with that, he secured her to the horse rail, turned and left. Well, Lincoln stood quietly for a moment, looking at the young woman. "What is your name?" he asked. And she didn't respond. "What are you called?" he repeated. Steeling herself for the inevitable blow, she set her jaw, stared at the ground, and still said nothing. Taking the bill of sale from his pocket, Lincoln read it carefully, then marked the bottom with his signature. Slowly he stooped, undid the clasp of her ankle irons, untied the rope that had cut into her wrists. "You're free to go, Sarah Jane," he said, handing her that document. "You're free to choose your own life now." And reaching into his pocket, he drew out a card and several coins. "If you have any trouble," he said, "call on me at this address and I will help you." As the reality of what she had heard seeped slowly through her brain into her muscles, the young woman grew weak and unable to sustain her rage. Minutes ticked by as anger gave way to confusion and confusion to disbelief. Like someone in the grip of a personal earthquake, shockwaves of agonizing hope rippled through the muscles in her face, and as she fought for her control, her jaw clenched and then settled again. Her muscular shoulders convulsed and then were still, and finally a large work calloused hand rose to take the papers and the money, and instantly she turned and ran, and Lincoln watched as she disappeared down the rutted road. Taking the reins of his horse, he began to mount her when they saw the slave girl suddenly stop. Some distance away, she stood totally still. More minutes passed. Then slowly, deliberately, she made her way back, and standing in front of him, she handed him the money. "I choose you," she said, looking up for the first time into Lincoln's gaunt, craggy face. "You say I choose my own life now," she continued haltingly, "that I work for who I want. You give me papers to show that I be free." And the deepest sinkholes of her oval face were wet with emotion. "If that be true, if I be free, then I choose you. Your life was bought with a price, far more precious than some dollars bid at an auction. You were bought with blood spilled at the top of a mountain from a cross. You, standing there in chains of mediocrity, were released and unbound. The one who paid your price has told you, you are free to choose your own life now. You can choose to rest comfortably in mediocre places. Jesus went to the cross for you and suffered pain for you with no strings attached. You may choose the life you wish, and you may run off in search of all kinds of things. But I'm compelled to tell you that the one who paid for your freedom stands watching, hoping that you'll stop in your tracks and turn around. He's waiting like a patient father of a prodigal child. He's waiting, hoping that you'll turn around, head up the rest of the mountain called Calvary, and tell him that you choose him, that you will work for him. I'm asking you to drop your commitment card in the box at the center aisle as you come up for communion. Some of you have already returned them to us. Some of you are doing so by online or by mail, so I know not everyone is going to be putting something in here today, but as you come by the box, consider two things. Our commitment to move beyond mediocrity, that is our gift of thanksgiving back to God. That's why this box looks like a gift. The second thing to consider is that this is on the way to communion. God's gift to you is food for the journey. God knows stretching is difficult and uncomfortable. He isn't going to leave you unprovisioned. He will sustain you along the way. Some Greeks came to find Jesus. I don't know if they were expecting to find a cross. When you came here today, were you expecting to find a cross? Or were you only coming halfway?
take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as You choose. Here am I, all of me. Take my life, it's all for Thee. Take my will and make it Thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is Thy own. It shall be Thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour. At Your feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for Thee. Here I am, all of me. Take my life, it's all for Thee.
If you'd please rise as you are able. The Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of Your people, turning us from our sin to live for You alone. Give us the power of Your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive Your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from You and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In Your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we've done and things we've failed to do. Turn us again to You and uphold us by Your Spirit so that we may live and serve You in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven, your shackles are released. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, save us from mediocrity. There is so much that interferes. Our intentions always seem good, and life can get in the way. Keep us focused on your cross. Make it the center of each day. And in doing so, may we help others to center their lives around you too. We ask for healing on behalf of those whom we love: Hank, Sharon, Verna, Jeannie, Tom, Brooklyn, Warren, Beverly, Jerry, Helen, John, Carolyn, and Jennifer, Leanne, David and Carol, Gloria, Carson, Lauren, Eric, Jessica, Kathy and Glenn, Alan and Sue, Judy, Richard, John, Delmi, Dean, Kelly, Frank, Andy, Brad, and those who remember silently before you now. Renew their bodies and minds and bring healing to them. We ask for comfort and hope for those who know loss of loved ones: the family of Bev Dara, the family of Jack Ponton, the family of Reverend Christopher Berry, Geraldine's family, and those who we remember silently before you now. Make the promise of resurrection certain in their lives. Surround those who grieve with support and concern. God, whose ways are different than our ways, we offer these commitments of our resources to you today, knowing that yours are the hands that multiply, and from you abundant living flows. Through the discipline of sacrificial giving, open us up to the marvel of your ways. Bless the efforts we make in expanding ministry throughout Palm Beach County and beyond. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. We have Thanksgiving Moment Part 2 today. You're going to get to hear more generosity stories and encouragement of you being able to share your own. So please direct your attention to the screens.
What were you looking for when you came to our church?
Well, a little over 25 years ago, we moved to Palm Beach Gardens, and we were looking for a church home. Our son and daughter-in-law were very active in Holy Spirit Lutheran Church and invited us to come to church. And we enjoyed the way the church operated, the smallness of the church.
What is your greatest hope for our church and the next generation that calls it their church home?
We pray that HSLC will continue its mission of spreading the radically inclusive love of Jesus through serving all God's children. We want families to have a lifelong relationship here. The most important events of our lives these past 38 years have happened at Holy Spirit: baptisms, confirmations, weddings, funerals, worshiping together, and celebrating with our church family.
The biggest hope that I have for HSLC is for us all to receive him, then grow in him, and then out in the community, just to expand his kingdom and his love.
I think continuing with a strong youth program is very critical. As we all get older, we need young blood to come in and pick up the pieces where we leave behind. So I think when you see a good, strong ministry like Holy Spirit Lutheran Church, it makes it a lot easier to look forward to the future.
When was the church most helpful to you?
The love and support we received at challenging times in our lives, times of loss, knowing that we weren't walking alone, that our HSLC family is always there through prayer and love, is such a gift.
Well, the church is the people, so it's when I'm spending time with them, in a passing, or in a wedding, or in a private moments, I'm honored that God has used this broken person to expand his kingdom and glorify him.
Last year, I was quite ill, and I was in the hospital in a rehab center for about 2 months, and I had never met Pastor Jim, but he was the first person there to see me, and he came quite often to the hospital and very often to the rehab. And it just meant so much to me. It was very, very comforting with his coming to visit me. And at the same time, the flowers, I was receiving flowers from the altar every week and beautiful, beautiful cards. And it was just so special. And it made me feel so special in such a hard time. And I just can't say enough about those ministries and about Pastor Jim. He just really helped me through a very, very tough time.
What do you appreciate most about the ministry of our church?
Don and I so appreciate our commitment to serving, to welcoming all, and in striving to always share Christ's love.
I really appreciate the fact that we care so deeply for those that are in need, not only in our church family, but outside our church family. Just like Jesus, we're reaching out to those that need it most.
Jamie in the choir is tremendous as a leader, and listening to her when we do prayer every Sunday after practice before we come into the congregation is pretty cool.
Of those as primers, and as you consider some of those own questions yourselves and share that with people, we know that your excitement is infectious, that draws others in. I'm a firm believer that people make up their mind about returning to a church upon their first visit based on the first 10 minutes of their experience. It has nothing to do with the guy that does the sermon or the people that are leading worship up front, but it's you and how you convey that friendly welcome. So I'd ask at this time that our ushers would collect our offerings and tithes in support of us being this community of faith God's called us to be.
For you, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more. I am reaching for the highest goal, that I might receive the prize. Pressing onward, pushing every hindrance aside, out of my way, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more.
If you would please rise as you're able. And let us pray. God, we give you thanks for this meal that you provide for us to sustain us on the journey so that we don't stop halfway and that we meet you all the way at the cross. Come and be present to us in this meal of remembrance. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We remember how on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, he gave it for all to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. If you chose to commune in your seats with those chalices you received at the door, you may open those now. That wafer, the body of Christ given for you. That wine or grape juice, the blood of Christ shed for you. The rest of you will be directed forward to one of two communion stations up front. Come, for all things are ready.
We all start out on the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give. Oh, the shape that we were in. Just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door. For us, he said, "Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table." Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. That sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table. To the thief and to the doubter, to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been let down, all the lost you have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong, to everyone who hears this song. Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come come to the table. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table.
Blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you, preserve you, keep you in grace always. Amen. And if you'd please rise as you're able, and let us pray. Gracious God, for this gift, we are grateful. May we carry this gift with us and become life to a world in desperate need. Through us, carry out your mission to the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in this desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away, give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.